can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, good morning. Good afternoon.
Yeah, it's evening right now in India.
Mm-hmm.
So the crowd inflow is continuing as yet. So we might just take another 5 minutes to get things settled down. So should that be fine?
Yes, that's fine. And just remind me about how long we have to talk with each other. When do we
sure,
need to finish?
So it'll maximum at max it'll go to 1.5 hours.
1.5. Okay. So my talk is for 1 hour, and we have time for a half hour questions then.
Yeah. That should do good. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes.
Hello. Hello, hello. Hello, hello.
It's coming there.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, hello.
Yeah, sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Hello. So I'm very sorry for the inconvenience. There's still crowd coming, pouring in. So we might just take another couple of minutes.
Okay, fine with me.
So for convenience, can we connect to you back again in another 5 minutes? Should it do?
Yes, sure. Yes, sure.
Okay, sir. Then in 5 minutes, we'll connect again.
Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Right.
I request all of you all to please settle down as soon as possible. So we are ready to go with.
Okay, that's great. So you have my first slide up, the history of the universe, the title slide.
Yes, we do have the PPT that you had sent.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you all for coming to hear my talk. I wanted to tell you the history of the universe and to talk about the work that we're doing with the James Webb Space Telescope at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. This is a picture of the telescope right in the front page here. You see a giant golden hexagon protected by a sun shield, which I will explain later. This is a telescope which will be launched in 2 years, in October of 2018, and everyone in the entire world will be able to use it. If you are an astronomer, you can send in a proposal about what you would like to observe, and it will be considered, and if your idea is good, then you will get the data. So we have about 10,000 professional astronomers in the world, and all of them will use the telescope. There are at least 1,000 engineers and technicians currently building the observatory, and at least 100 scientists currently involved, as well as 3 international space agencies, NASA, the European Space Agency, and the Canadian Space Agency, all working on this project. So let's move on to our next chart here.
Yeah,
I wanted to step back. Okay, questions? I see you with the microphones there. Okay. So stepping back 400 and a bit years in time, we go back to the first astronomical telescopes, which were not invented by Galileo, but were improved greatly by him. His design was quite simple, with 2 lenses, one converging lens, primary lens, and one diverging lens called the eyepiece lens. With this telescope, he was able to get a 33 magnification power looking at the sky. I'm seeing that you're seeing a different slide from the one that I am showing. So the one I'm showing is called Galileo 1609. There we go. And many of the slides in the slide set that I sent were not going to be shown because there are too many of them for the 1 hour that we have. Anyway, Galileo built this telescope, learned how to make better lenses, and was able to map the surface of the moon and show that it had craters on it and what he called seas, the maria, and of course also discovered that Venus had a crescent phase, showing that it goes around the sun, discovering that the satellites of Jupiter orbit around it, and we named them after him, the Galilean satellites, and of course got him into a great deal of difficulty with religious leaders in his day who believed that nothing could have been improved over the ancients. So in my next chart, I have, it should say, looking back in time. Good. So this one is an example showing that astronomers and everyone can look back in time by looking at things that are far away. When you look at something that's 1 meter away, you see it as it was 3 nanoseconds ago. If you look at the sun, you see it as it was 500 seconds ago. And if you could look all the way back to the Big Bang, what we call the Big Bang, it would be actually about 14 billion years ago, which means that the light would have been traveling for 14 billion years on its way to get to our eyes. So on the next chart, I want to illustrate how we measure these things. Here we have an example of trigonometry. If you want to measure the distance to a star, you can draw a triangle. If you know one side of a triangle and the 2 angles of a triangle, then you can calculate the entire distance to the star, as we've known for some thousands of years how to do this. We can do this because the Earth orbits around the sun, and so the position of our observer changes over time, and we can now draw the triangle this way. To observe more distant objects, we use something called the standard candle method. Now, if I can promise you that I have 2 luminous objects, 2 candles that are really identical, but one looks fainter to us, we say that it's because it's farther away, according to the inverse square law of brightness. So now we can measure the distance to everything in the entire universe with these two methods. They're very geometrical. So on the next chart, the other main thing we need to have is how do you measure speed of motion? So if you can observe the spectrum of an object, spread out the light of a star or the sun into its colors, and you look in the upper left-hand corner, you will see that we can see the chemical constituents of a star. Each of those dark lines across the rainbow where it says absorption line spectrum, that's very much like what we see in the surface of the sun. Each molecule, each atom, each ion in the surface of the sun absorbs certain wavelengths and certain colors, and those are set by quantum mechanics, so they are fixed throughout space and throughout time as far as we know. So now we know what the colors of light really are, as well as being able to measure the temperature, the chemistry, the physics, the pressure, all kinds of things of the luminous object. So if we see a more distant object, quite often we will discover that all the wavelengths have been multiplied or divided by some number so that they are all shifted in wavelength. So if we see this pattern, we quite often will interpret it as saying that the universe is expanding or that the objects are going away from us. So the little picture there shows that if the object is coming towards you, the waves come more frequently to you and the wavelengths are shorter. And so we call those are blue. If the object is going away from you, then we say that they are longer wavelengths and they are red. So this now gives us a method for measuring the velocity of something coming toward us or away from us anywhere in the universe. So now I'll show you some pictures of this of telescopes that were developed to start this research program. Back in the late 1800s, George Ellery Hale was in Chicago, which was a very prosperous city at that time in the United States, still is, and he persuaded rich people to build a telescope. So the 40-inch or approximately 1 meter diameter telescope is shown there in the upper left-hand corner. Quite soon it was realized that the weather is not very good where they built that telescope and that it wasn't big enough anyway. So they decided to build the next one in California. This shown there is a 60-inch or 1.5-meter telescope, which was on Mount Wilson in Southern California. The next one that's shown there is the 100-inch, 2.5 meters, and is actually the same size as the Hubble telescope that we have in space today. So that was in use in the early 1900s. It was used for many of the great discoveries of the expansion of the universe. The fourth telescope I show here is called the Palomar Observatory, and it was twice as large as the previous one, and it was not completed until after the World War II was finished. So in the next chart, we show you Edwin Hubble himself. In the left corner, Edwin Hubble got to master the telescope. In those days, we had no automatic guiding system, so what you had to do was to keep a guide star on the crosshairs in the eyepiece and so that you would get a sharp photograph of whatever you wanted to study. The other half of the picture here shows a graph that he made for us. The graph shows that the distant galaxies appear to be going away from us. Each of these dots represents a single galaxy, and you can see that the on the horizontal direction axis is plotted the distance in astronomers' units of parsecs. On the vertical direction is plotted the velocity of motion. And you see that there's a trend here, that the farther away they are, the faster they're going. So in 1929, this picture was published, and it was immediately international news. And many people immediately interpreted it as saying the universe is expanding. So Hubble himself was an experimenter. He was not immediately convinced by this, but this was the observation that gave us what we now call the Big Bang Theory, the experimental evidence for it. Now, in fact, he was not the first person to think of it, but this was the convincing evidence from observations. Excuse me. If you divide the distance by the speed, you obtain the inverse slope of this curve here, or this line, and that is the age of the universe. Divide the distance by the speed, you get the age of the universe. Hubble got 2 billion years, 2,000 million years, which is actually incorrect. It's incorrect because the method that he used for determining distance depended on the standard candles, and the candles that he was using were different in the nearby stars as they were in the distant galaxies. So now we know that the actual number is about 14 billion years, but it still works to divide the distance by the speed to get the age of the universe. So in the next chart, we have a picture of the antenna. Oh, I think we've got to one that we need to get to, the one that's called Finding the Big Bang. There we go. So this is an antenna that was built at Bell Telephone Laboratories in New Jersey to communicate with satellites and also to do a little bit of astronomy. And the two scientists who were building this were extremely cautious and careful, and they said, we think that there's extra noise coming out of our radio receiver, and it should not be there. So what is the cause of that? And they could not find the cause. They just concluded that it was not on Earth. Pretty soon it was, however, revealed to them that this could be the cosmic microwave background radiation, the cosmic heat of the early universe. So that was in 1964. They published their data in 1965. And a few years later, they received the Nobel Prize for discovering this cosmic background radiation, which is an extremely strong piece of the evidence for the expanding universe story. So now jumping ahead to a picture of the Cosmic Background Explorer spacecraft. So we're jumping ahead here. I'm skipping over some charts so that we have time for questions. There we go. Back up one. Thank you. This is the picture of the Cosmic Background Explorer satellite, which was proposed by us in 1974, when I was just barely out of graduate school. We proposed to measure this cosmic heat. So the radiation had only been discovered a few years before that, but we all knew that if we could measure it very well, it would be a tremendously important part of the evidence for or against the Big Bang story, the expanding universe story. So we built that and flew it in 1989, and it observed the cosmic microwave background radiation very, very beautifully. So in my next chart, I'll show you our first main result from the observations. Graph here shows the brightness of the cosmos versus the frequency of the waves we were receiving. So it's frequency units here are cycles per centimeter, so a wavelength of 1 millimeter is right here in the middle of the horizontal axis. The theoretical prediction is the smooth curve, and all the observations, as you can see, fall exactly on the smooth curve. When we showed this curve to the Astronomical Society, we received a standing ovation for our discovery and our measurement. And I thought at first, well, why are they so pleased with this? Because doesn't everyone know that the universe has to do this? The answer was, of course, no. We had many incorrect observations before this that suggested that, in fact, the expanding universe story could not be correct. So in the next chart, we'll go to a picture that shows the cover of Physics Today magazine from 1992. This was our second major discovery. So what we have here are maps of the sky showing the brightness of the cosmos at measured at wavelengths of a few millimeters from our satellite. It took us several years to make these maps, and so it was a huge technical accomplishment, requiring observing hundreds of millions of times and then collecting the data and processing them through a least squares fitting program in the computer. So the top picture is a map of the entire sky, just like a map of the Earth, but compressed onto an ellipse. And it shows that one direction, the pink area, is brighter than the other by approximately one part in a thousand. And that's because the Earth is moving in that direction towards the bright area at approximately one part in a thousand of the speed of light. So that's the Doppler effect. When we removed that effect numerically and subtracted it from the image, we saw the one in the middle, which is a map that shows hot and cold spots, as well as a red area across the center, which is due to the electrons in our own galaxy. So we, however, expected that as well. We were able to subtract that from the map, and we obtained the map at the very bottom, which is a map of hot and cold spots in the original expanding universe material. So these spots turn out to be extremely, extremely important. When Stephen Hawking saw this picture, he said it was the most important scientific discovery of the century, if not of all time. So I did not know right away why he thought it was so important, but now I can tell you many reasons. Number one, those are the sources of the gravitational force that would cause galaxies to grow. So we are here because of those spots. Number two, most of those spots come from dark matter, cosmic dark matter, which only astronomers are able to detect so far, but we're quite sure that it's there. And the third reason that it's important is it tells us something, if we ever can understand it, about the quantum mechanics and the extreme temperatures and pressures of the early universe. So we're still hunting for the what we call the grand unified theory that would connect gravitation with quantum mechanics, and we don't have it yet. But when we do, it should be able to explain this this pattern. So on the next chart, I have an illustration. Let's see, skip that. It should say Hubble's Law. There we go. Hubble's Law does not imply that there's a center. Everyone thinks that the universe is rushing away from us, so we must be in the center. In fact, there is no center in the observable universe. The illustration suggests that the three astronomers are all watching each other race apart. The astronomer on the left would say, I can calculate the age of the universe by dividing the distance by the time, and I say the universe is 1 hour old, or the race started 1 hour ago. If you imagine what the astronomer in the middle would calculate, that astronomer would compute the same thing. The race started 1 hour ago. But of course, in outer space, there's no grass. No one knows who's moving and who is not. So the conclusion is that although it feels like we are at the center of the expanding universe, actually, we calculate that every astronomer on every galaxy throughout the entire universe will believe that he or she is at the center of the universe. So the conclusion is that there is no center. So when you ask, as people often do at the end of a talk, well, where was the Big Bang? The answer is that it was everywhere. It is not located at a point. That's a misinterpretation that many people have. So in the next picture, you just have an illustration that I cannot draw you a picture. If I were able to draw you a picture, it would mean that I was standing in a higher dimensional space. We have three space dimensions and time. We cannot, in principle, even stand outside the universe and draw you a picture of an explosion. So when people draw you a picture of an explosion, it's wrong. So in my next chart, I talk about how did we get here. So the answer that we have is that gravitational force reaching across immense distances of space is able to stop the expansion of the material and pull it back together. So if a region of original universe is more dense than average, then it will have more gravity than average, and it will pull itself back together. So as it falls in together, then it begins to collapse into objects. Heat is produced in the collapsing process. The heat then escapes and enables the collapse to continue. So this is the fundamental force that causes the complex universe that we now have, is gravity. Gravity pulls things together and makes them unstable. After they are pulled together, of course, then we have the nuclear reactions of hydrogen and helium to produce heavier elements in the sun and the other stars. And then, now, of course, we ourselves are made out of those heavier elements. So here in the next chart, illustrate that we have a very, very large telescope that has just barely been completed in South America. This is called the Atacama Large Millimeter Array. The Atacama is a very, very high altitude desert, extremely, extremely dry. It's a place where people have been living and keeping records for 500 years, and it did not rain, not once, for 500 years in this place. So these are radio telescopes. They are connected by computers and fiber optics and extremely fancy electronics. And however, they are now able to use these various antennas connected together to produce an image of a very distant object that matters deeply to us. The picture in the upper left corner there with the orange and red ellipses is actually an image of a star in the center surrounded by dust grains in the process of forming planets. This is the first direct image we've ever had that shows a star forming planets. So we imagine that this object is only a few million years old and that the dust grains are orbiting around it in the process. So in the dark regions between the light bright ones, we think that there's a planet in there receiving the dust grains and collecting them. So if we can understand this picture, then we can hope to understand the formation of our own solar system. In the next picture, illustrate a telescope that is now being built called the Square Kilometer Array. If you can imagine a telescope with a kilometer dimensions, kilometer collecting area, it's going to be large and complicated. This particular one is an international project in which the United States is not really participating, but there are two parts of it, one to be finished in the desert in Western Australia, where no one lives, another one in the desert in Southern Africa, again, where very few people live. These telescopes operate at wavelengths where there would be interference from cell phones. So that's one of the reasons that they put the telescopes way out in the desert, far away from people. It is calculated, by the way, that when this telescope is in operation, if there is a planet out there with living people and airplanes, and if they have radars to operate at their airports, we would be able to tell that that planet out there has radars operating to control aircraft. I don't expect that we will see that, but of course people will want to try. So in the next picture, I show you adaptive optics. So back in the 1950s, it was imagined that there would be a way sometime where we would be able to compensate for the shimmering and dancing of the Earth's atmosphere. As you know, it's very difficult to get a sharp image of a star from the ground because the atmosphere above us is always dancing around and making it a poor image. So even a great telescope on the top of a mountain doesn't do very much better in terms of image sharpness than a pair of binoculars. So the idea was to receive some light from the telescope and to control the an adaptive mirror that compensates for the dancing atmosphere. And if you can do that, then you can make a sharp image. So now this has been invented more than once and is now in operation at most astronomical telescopes, and it's working beautifully. So we now can do this, and all of the big telescopes of the future will have them too. The right-hand picture, by the way, illustrates that the same mathematics that was invented to do that also works for studying the inside of a human eye. If your eye doctor wants to see the back of your eye, he needs to look, or she needs to look through the lens of your own eye in order to see through to the back. And so the same concept works very well for measuring that. And if you are very determined, you can have laser surgery on your eye so that you will see better. So you can have vision that's about twice as good as normal human beings have by using this technique to guide the laser surgeon. So in my next chart, I have pictures of telescopes on Hawaii. These telescopes are made out of segmented mirrors, and they're very big and powerful. They belong to the United States. On the right-hand side of the picture are four enormous telescopes in the mountains in Chile, and they are actually made with single pieces of glass. Very, very powerful telescopes there. So those are the ones that we have today. We are, of course, building bigger ones. So in the next chart, I show you images of the three even larger telescopes that are now being prepared. There is a telescope called the Giant Magellan Telescope. We'll go into a place in Chile, and that's made with seven gigantic individual pieces of glass, as you see there in the picture. There is a European extremely large telescope, almost 40 meters in size. That's also going to be built in Chile, and they've already started construction there. And there's an American version called the 30-meter telescope, which is planned for construction in Hawaii, although that one has been stopped for a while because of some legal difficulties there. So all of these telescopes are coming along, and they will produce huge breakthroughs in astronomy for the wavelengths that they can see from the ground. Now, these telescopes are primarily good for the wavelengths that you and I can see, visible wavelengths and near-infrared, where the atmosphere is transparent. So in the next chart, I have a picture of the Hubble Space Telescope. Hubble has now been in operation for 26 years in space, and it is doing beautifully. As you know, astronauts have been up to visit it five times to repair it and improve it. And it is far more powerful than it was when it was originally conceived and launched back in 1990. So the telescope in space has the advantage that there's no atmosphere to bother it, no atmosphere to block the incoming light. So this telescope functions at much shorter wavelengths than you can see from the ground. It observes ultraviolet. Of course, we are very glad here on the ground to have ultraviolet protection. Otherwise, we would all be sunburned in the daytime. But this telescope gets above the atmosphere and can observe those wavelengths coming from distant stars as well. So in the next chart, I have a picture taken by the Hubble. It took about 2 weeks pointing the telescope in one direction for the entire 2 weeks to wait for the light from the distant galaxies to accumulate on the detectors. So in this picture, there's one star that you can see. So in the lower right-hand corner with red and blue spikes sticking out of it. All of the rest of these things are galaxies. So when the Hubble team decided to point the telescope in this direction originally, they chose it because they did not think there was anything there. And they had a wonderful surprise. This individual picture includes thousands and thousands of remote galaxies, and they're able to see that they're very different when we look back in time. What we see here are galaxies of every possible shape. Round ones, spiral ones, little irregular ones, and particularly interesting for astronomers are the little red dots. The tiny red dots are the ones from the most distant galaxies where the light has been stretched out by the expansion of the universe. Originally started out as visible and ultraviolet light, ends up as red and infrared light. So that lets us understand something about the formation of galaxies, because right here in front of us we can understand the progression from the small irregular ones far away and far back in time to the large complex ones that we see nearby today. In the next chart, I have the Whirlpool Nebula. This is a beautiful picture taken again with the Hubble Space Telescope, and you see the spiral structure of a nearby galaxy. You also see that the galaxy has a friend, a neighbor, which is in the process of colliding with the big one. When those two meet in a few hundred million years, a tremendous collision will occur, and both the galaxies will be completely disrupted. The spiral picture does show you the spiral arms of a typical spiral galaxy. Shows different colors to show you the different phases of star formation. The little pink areas that you see are places where stars have just been formed. The blue colors that you see come from new stars that have been ejected from their original birthplaces, because new stars typically are very blue. So this is a place that resembles our own Milky Way galaxy, And if the solar system were in this galaxy, it would be near the outside edge. In the next picture, I show you the Crab Nebula. This is an example of a star which exploded. In actual time, it was observed by humanity in AD 1054. It was so bright that you could see it in the daytime anywhere on the Earth. And so we know what day it was because we still have written records from Chinese astronomers who would tell us when it happened. We now observe it with the Hubble Space Telescope. We see the debris cloud is flying apart. We can say, yes, indeed, it did happen in AD 1054. And we can also analyze the chemical composition of this debris. This is a very important part of our own human story because stars like this that exploded propelled their material back out into outer space so that it could be recycled and produce new stars and new planets. So the chemical elements of life, the ones that you and I are made of, were produced in explosions like this. And we are here, you and I, having this conversation because these kinds of stars exploded and produced the elements for us to be here. So in the next picture, I illustrate a very strange discovery. Skip ahead to one called Galaxies Attract Each Other, please. There we go. So this picture illustrates that astronomers believed, after the expansion of the universe was discovered, that surely the universe must be slowing down due to the gravitational force pulling the galaxies together. So we spent about 50 years expecting this result, but it turns out not to be true. So in the next picture, I have a picture of three young men who are parts of teams that discovered the acceleration of the universe. It's actually going faster and faster every year. There were two different teams that made this discovery, and they shared the Nobel Prize in 2011 for their work. So the reason for this is unknown and may never be known, but we call it dark energy to give a name for something that we don't know. Some near, we may know whether this is a true thing that we can study, or it might also just be a feature of Einstein's equations because he told us it would be possible. And now, in the next chart, I want to start talking about the James Webb Space Telescope, which is the project that I work on at NASA Goddard. This is an international project, as I mentioned when we started, involving the NASA with the European and Canadian space agencies. The project is being led at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, where I work, and we have one very large aerospace corporation that works with us called Northrop Grumman, as well as many smaller companies that you might have heard of. By the way, if you as students wish to become aerospace engineers, this is one of the ways that people come to the United States to work for NASA, is that they work for large aerospace companies like this. You don't have to be a U.S. citizen to do that. So this is the entry point for many people from India to decide to come to the United States to do aerospace. You work for big aerospace corporations. So the observatory has this gigantic mirror that you see, this golden hexagon that collects the light from the distant galaxies. It also has four instruments, cameras and spectrographs that make images and analyze the light into the colors. And those come from around the world from all of the different partners. The observatory is to be operated by the Space Telescope Science Institute in Baltimore, which again is a place for the astronomers to come to decide what to point the telescope at, and for us to receive the data from this from the observatory and process it into the images that astronomers need. So the telescope is 6.5 meters in diameter after it's unfolded in outer space. It operates at a very low temperature. It says cryogenic temperature, which means approximately 45 Kelvin, 45 degrees above absolute zero for the temperature of the telescope. It is going to be launched by a European rocket called the Ariane 5 about October of 2018 to a place called the Sun-Earth Lagrange Point 2, which is about 1.5 million kilometers from here. And I think I have a picture of the orbit for you. So we are planning to operate for 10 years. We have fuel in the tanks for 10 years of scientific operation. By the way, if you want to see how we're doing with the observatory, there is the website for us, jwst.nasa.gov. And if you go to that site, you can even see people working on the telescope each day. People are in the clean room in their bunny suits to keep the telescope clean. This week they are putting on thermal blankets to keep the telescope at the right temperature. So in my next chart, a picture of the telescope itself. You see this gigantic mirror made out of 18 golden hexagons. So I'm not sure that you're seeing my next chart yet. There we go. So each of these hexagons is about 1.3 meters in size, and the combination makes it 6.5 meters across. So all those 18 hexagons will be adjusted into the right place after launch. Of course, the telescope is too large and too flexible to be kept in focus during the launch site, during the launch. The next picture shows you where we are putting the observatory. I think this one shows JWST orbits the Sun-Earth Lagrange point 2. So you may need to skip ahead here. Ahead again a little bit. There we go. So the observatory is going to be orbiting 1.5 million kilometers farther out from the Sun than the Earth. So it's four times as far out as the Moon is from us. And these five points, these 5 points are places where this combined force of the gravity of the Sun and the Earth will take the observatory around the Sun once a year. And we like this one, the L2 point, because it stays close to Earth. And so close to Earth, it's only 1.5 million kilometers away. We can stay in easy communication with it. It still takes, however, 5 seconds for the radio waves to go each direction from here to there. So in the next chart, I show you the observatory unfolding. I hope that you will see a movie showing the unfolding of the telescope. So I'm not seeing, I don't think you're seeing my movie yet. That's the one. So you should see the first thing that happens is the unfolding of the solar panels. And then the antenna comes out so that we can communicate well with the observatory. Then the sun shield begins to unfold. These are giant carbon fiber structures that hold the thin sheets of plastic. Then we separate the telescope a little bit more from the warm parts of the observatory. Then we unroll the plastic covers over the sun shield. This is all done by remote control, motors and cables and release mechanisms, all done by remote control. Here we are now pulling on the cables that separate the layers of the sun shield so that it will be able to protect the telescope enough. Then we finally unfold the secondary mirror and unfold the mirror itself. At this point, it's about 2 weeks after launch. The telescope will not be cold enough to focus it yet for another month or two. And finally, the observatory will be ready for scientific operations 6 months after launch, so April 2019, for the first scientific observations to come to you. So you might ask, isn't that awfully complicated? And of course it is. So in the next video, I have for you a movie of the expansion of the universe. See if we can get that to play. Yes, what you have here is a supercomputer simulation of the formation of the first galaxies. So each of these little blue dots here is a galaxy in the process of formation. The simulation says, well, let's imagine that we know how the universe was when it was young, and just let it run under the force of gravity. Gravity pulling the material together and causing the formation of galaxies and stars. So what we have here are galaxies being formed in huge sheets and strings. Then occasionally explosions occur. These are where gigantic black holes are being born and huge amounts of energy are being released. So in this simulation, as time goes along, there you see your explosions. The universe is an extremely exciting and violent place early on. When we reached the age of the universe of about 9 billion years, that's when the solar system is formed, and it's also a time when most of these explosions have come to an end. So as the galaxies settle down and it's possible for the solar system to form, we imagine that the chemical elements of life will already have been produced by exploding stars and recycled into solar systems like ours. So one of the big questions for astronomers is, have we got everything necessary to make a proper movie? So is this really the story of the universe, or is there something that we're missing? And does the calculation represent reality? We don't know yet. That's one of the purposes for building a telescope, to make observations to see whether the picture matches the real thing. So there's the list of the people who built this supercomputer simulation. Millions of CPU hours were required for that work. So let's see, we're going to skip ahead to a picture called Nature's Lenses in Space, if you please. Good. This is an illustration that Einstein gave us extra lenses for our telescope. He didn't really, but he describes how gravity can focus light. So what we have here is a picture of a cloud of thousands and thousands of bright galaxies called the galaxy cluster, and the gravitational force of the galaxies there is sufficient to focus the light from an even more distant galaxy, which you see in the upper right corner. A little pink arc up there is actually a much more distant galaxy that's been magnified by about 30 times by the gravitational force of the other galaxies that you see nearby. So nature gives us this extra lens to add to our telescope, and we can hope to see much, much more about the very first galaxies to form from the early universe. So in the next picture, the Eagle Nebula shows you one of our most beautiful pictures from the Hubble. This is a place where stars have just been born and are still being born, and you see them inside and along with these dark clouds of dust. Now, the dust is a very important part of the formation of stars. It's the solid material that produces planets, but it also obscures our view. We cannot see inside those dust clouds very well with a telescope that works at visible wavelengths. But in the next picture, I show you the Eagle Nebula as seen in the infrared wavelength range. This telescope was in South America, and it can observe the beginning of infrared. So you see a completely different picture. The dust clouds are much less opaque. You can see inside. There are objects we could not have seen before at all. And these are new stars being formed today. So scientists will be using the infrared capabilities of the Webb telescope to look inside these kinds of clouds. So in the next chart, I'll show you two movies, I hope, showing a planet going in front of its star and then a planet going behind its star. When either of these ones happen, the total light from the object diminishes slightly because one object is blocking the light from the other one. And this now enables us to search for planets around other stars. Now, usually the alignment is not correct for us to be able to see this. Maybe only 1% of planets will pass in front of their stars, but 1% is still enough so that we can find thousands and thousands of planets like this. The Kepler Observatory has already done so, and we have many other examples as well. So the capability that we now have is that because some of the starlight passes through the planetary atmosphere on its way to our telescope, we can now analyze the chemistry and physical properties of those planetary atmospheres. So we can look for, eventually, whether the chemical constituents of a planet like Earth match those of Earth itself. Is there oxygen? Is there carbon dioxide? Is there water? Is there methane? All the things that we think of as making Earth like Earth, we can eventually find out whether other planets around other stars have those same atmospheric properties. With the Webb telescope, we will probably not be able to see whether a planet has oxygen because that's not included in the right wavelength range for the Webb telescope. By the way, the Webb telescope is designed to observe infrared light primarily. The wavelength range goes from 0.6 microns, which is red, which you can see with your eye, to 28 microns, much, much longer, which you can feel with your fingers, feel the heat, but we're not very sensitive to it. So we open up a whole new territory of science with infrared astronomy with the Webb telescope. So what do we do next? We have in mind even larger telescopes than the Webb telescope. We have the Hubble telescope in the upper left corner of this picture, then the Webb in the middle, and eventually, and maybe in 20 or 30 years, we hope to have an even much larger telescope that would be able to see at short wavelengths like the Hubble and be able to pick up the signs of life like oxygen in the atmosphere of another planet. So people often want to know, well, how far can humans go into space? So I think quite far, but not as far as we want. So the first step, of course, is to send robots everywhere. We have them have been to visit all the planets. We have rovers roving around on Mars. We even have a lander that landed on the moon of Saturn some years ago. We've landed on Venus, although an observatory cannot last very long because it's too hot there. So we have robots everywhere. Robots are drilling holes in the bottom of the ocean to get oil and gas. They drill holes in mountains so we can have tunnels. Robots are getting better and better. And computers are getting smarter and smarter, so many of you probably already have been working on very fancy computers. Of course, the big issue for humanity is who's going to own and control those computers, and it's a good question. As to people, people are definitely need to be protected from outer space. We do not like cosmic rays. It makes us sick. We need to breathe. We don't like zero gravity. What we ideally would have would be improved power for very rapid travel. At the moment, what we have are chemical rockets, like the big ones that you know. We have been improving and developing the electric rockets using a solar power or even potentially nuclear reactors to drive electrical drives that to send out plasma into the space at much higher speeds than you can get with chemical rockets. Ultimately, people would love to have a hydrogen fusion drive to be able to travel very far, very fast, but that's not yet possible even on Earth, much less in space. I think in the very long term, robots will be able to go very far. There is, as you know, probably already a plan to send small, very small payloads near this up to a quarter of the speed of light by pushing them with laser beams to go into the very distant to see if they can go visit distant stars. So I think robots will go very far, but I don't know how far. So let's move ahead to the winding up here. I have a chart here about Technovanza 2016. I think most of you know that the Technovanza will be happening. This is just a reminder that it'll be where you are in December, and there'll be many events for people to participate in. So I hope you'll be able to come to that as well. So to conclude, there's much more information, as I show on my picture here. The next chart shows the picture of the book that I did called The Very First Light, and some websites that you can see to get more information. So that's my chart set, and I'm very happy now to have questions from you all about whatever I mentioned or anything else that's of interest to you. Thanks very much for coming.
So thank you very much. So we have a lot of people who want to ask you questions, and we also have some questions from Twitter. So I'll ask you some of those first. Yeah. So this one's is by Vivek Ajge, and he asks, "What is meant by a flat universe?"
Okay, Vivek, the question about a flat universe. We would like to know whether Euclid's geometry is correct. Euclid told us that the sum of the angles of a triangle is 180 degrees. That's true as far as we can measure everywhere here on Earth. On the other hand, it might not be true in space. So the question relates to Einstein's gravity. Einstein told us that gravitation operates by curving space and time. The universe is not stable and is controlled by gravity, then what about that? So the measurement is telling us, according to interpretation, of course, that the universe is actually flat, that if we were to take a geometrical description of all the points that are, say, 13.8 billion years after the expansion started, that and you draw a triangle in that imaginary space, that the angles would indeed add up to 180 degrees, just as Euclid said. Now, that's what we mean by spatially flat. Now, space-time as a four-dimensional structure is still curved by gravitational forces and by the expansion, but that's what we mean by a flat universe.
Thank you, sir. Our next question is by Sagar Hinduja, who asks, who was your role model?
Oh, I have so many role models. The people that inspired me first when I was a young person, Galileo and Darwin, I think, were my favorites. I think I was about 8 years old when I started hearing about them and knowing what they had done. And I concluded that science was very exciting, that there was a possibility to discover something completely new and different. And also, I was aware that it was a little bit dangerous because people wouldn't always like your new information. Galileo was locked up in his house for many years because he had told people things they did not want to hear. Darwin, of course, as you know, found us the idea of evolution. And although he was a very deeply religious man, the other religious people of his day were very upset. So that was also a very great challenge for him. But they were my heroes.
So our next question is by Akshay Bondre, who asks, could you share with us some info about the OSIRIS-REx, which was going to be launched today?
Okay, I don't know very much about it, but I can tell you that it is going to visit an asteroid. It will try to bring a sample back to Earth so we can analyze some of that particular asteroid. So everyone wants to know, how was the Earth formed? How was the solar system formed? So the asteroids give us some samples of the material that was there before they all collided and produced larger objects. So we imagine that the solar system was assembled from small dust grains growing to larger dust grains, growing into small planets, and then the small planets colliding with each other to make big planets. So this is a chance to get a sample of the material before it had collided and grown into very large objects. So some people think that the asteroids will be full of very valuable materials, and this would be a first step towards learning whether space mining is a practical thing to do. Are there materials out there that were so valuable for people here on Earth that it would be worth going to get an asteroid to bring it back?
Thank you, sir. Now we'll entertain questions from the crowd present here. So the first question is by Aditya Shah.
Good afternoon, sir. It's a great honor to have you present with us through the seminar. My question basically is stressed over the work of LIGO. Could you shed some more basic information about LIGO's work in the field of gravitational waves and what they basically are and what is the significance of the discovery? And secondly, I'm also aware that they'll be setting up a laboratory here in India soon enough. So, and that there is some geographical significance to the location of the laboratories. So how does the geography make a difference to the working of the LIGO instruments? So were you able to hear me out?
Yes, I hear you. And if we could put the chart number 55 that I skipped over on your screen, you'll see a diagram.
Yes, so 1 second.
So it was predicted by Einstein back in 1916 that if sufficiently violent occurrence might happen, that gravitational waves might travel through space. So if you were to imagine just a small pair of objects orbiting quickly around each other, you would imagine that there was a small fluctuating gravitational force coming to you from them. What Einstein showed was that this is possible to travel through space at the speed of light across immense distances. Now, he imagined that we would never be able to measure it. Beginning almost 50 years ago, colleagues of mine and people around the world started thinking, well, maybe it is possible. And so they said, well, what if two black holes were to collide with each other and merge together to make a single black hole? Then there should be a variation of gravitational force that would be able to travel across space to our detector. So they proposed to build it. The thing that they needed to build is called a laser interferometer. So you build a structure that can tell whether gravitational force has changed the spacing between two mirrors as it goes by. So they built it, and after almost all these many decades, they achieved a sufficient sensitivity for it to work. So I think back when was in February that they announced their first discovery of two black holes colliding, that each of them of roughly 30 times the mass of the sun and about 1.3 billion light years away. Nevertheless, the strength of the signal was sufficient for them to measure it. So it's an extremely great triumph of engineering and science for us to be able to do this. Now, how do you know where it was? Well, you need to measure the direction. So the single detector here does not tell you the direction. But if you have two or three, then you have information because the signal will arrive at different receivers at different times. So the timing of the event as seen from different places on Earth gives you the direction in space. So that's the big thing to try to do, is to learn where they are from. So adding an additional antenna in Europe and another one in India will help tremendously to determine what direction these objects are. So also I should mention that we are now opening up a new territory of astronomy, because nothing was known about these objects before. Now we know that there are a lot of these large, massive black hole pairs, and it was not expected by astronomers. So this is a huge, huge beginning of a new kind of astronomy to be able to study these objects. And black holes are important to us because they affect the nearby territory so much. When a black hole forms in the center of a galaxy, as it has in our own galaxy, and material falls in, huge amounts of energy are liberated, and it becomes a very dangerous place for instance, for a civilization. Too much energy going by could completely fry a planet that had life on it.
So, yes, sir, I wanted to ask a question. Like when NASA says that a spacecraft goes at 64 kilometers per second, what is it like? They're measuring the speed with respect to what? And like, there's a connected question. Like, is there any true inertial frame of reference in the universe?
Okay, so always when you announce a speed of motion, you have to say relative to what. So I'm not sure what that announcement that you saw was about. As you know, the orbit speed of the Earth around the Sun is about 30 kilometers per second. So if we want to go somewhere else, like out of the solar system, we have to go a lot faster than that. So
I read that the Juno spacecraft went at a top speed of 64 kilometers per second. So what are we measuring the speed with respect to? Like, what is the frame of reference?
I think in that case, they would be using the frame of reference of the solar system itself relative to the Sun. So, and you also ask, is there a standard frame of reference? So, or of an inertial frame of reference. So the inertial frame of reference is something where it's not accelerating. So here on Earth, our frame of reference is not exactly inertial because you can feel the gravitational force pulling things down. But if you were in a laboratory with no windows and you are, and your laboratory was falling in the gravitational field of the Earth, you would not know. And that would be called an inertial frame of reference. You would feel no gravitational force within your laboratory.
So, but like everything is getting accelerated in the universe, so like...
Yes.
So how can we say that something is inertial?
It's a local definition. Inertial frame of reference is the one in which there's no internal acceleration, or there's no, when you try to measure the acceleration of objects in that frame due to gravity, there's none. So.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So, thank you for a very enriching lecture, sir. I would like to ask a question about the mapping of the universe using background radiation. I read somewhere that you map the background using infrared radiation, but according to you, which part of the electromagnetic spectrum is the most accurate to map the background radiation, sir?
Okay, we used millimeter waves. The cosmic microwave radiation has the peak brightness around 2 millimeters in wavelength. So that's the best place to go to make a good map.
Is that the most accurate that we have been able to achieve, or can we go farther?
That's the best we can do. And that wavelength is chosen partly because the universe is bright at that wavelength, and also because we have to measure at nearby wavelengths to understand the interference that we get from dust grains and electrons that are nearby. I showed you the three ovals, and the middle oval showed you the bright red region due to the Milky Way galaxy. Those are electrons primarily, and so we have to subtract that in order to measure the part that's cosmic.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
First of all, thanks for having this lecture, sir. As I like to ask that, as we know that the universe is expanding.
Yes, your sound disappeared there for a moment.
As we know that the universe is expanding, I would like to ask that what is exactly the universe is expanding into? And so what is exactly the space where universe is expanding?
So the universe is expanding into itself. The universe is probably infinite to begin with, even when it was young, and it is expanding into itself. So this is always a surprise for people because people call it the Big Bang as though it were a firecracker, a small explosion, which is exactly the opposite of what astronomers observe. We observe the entire universe expanding, not a small explosion. So the universe is expanding into itself. There is no center. There is no edge. There is not even a first moment. The first moment does not exist.
Okay, but we know that the energy can neither be created nor destroyed. It can be only transferred. But what is exactly means, as the universe is expanding, we would be having, you know, some regions where there would be no energy at all, and some regions where there will be a huge amount of energy.
Yes, it's true. There are different amounts of energy, different amounts of material in different regions of the early universe. And those are the ones that lead to the spots on the map of the microwave radiation and that lead to the existence of galaxies today. So we don't really know how that all started. That's a problem that's wide open for future research.
Okay, thanks.
Hello, sir. Thank you for the enlightening lecture. I had a doubt. You mentioned that the Big Bang, it did not originate from a single point, but it started everywhere. It didn't originate from one point. So are you implying that physical quantities like volume and space existed before the Big Bang ever occurred?
We do not really know what occurred prior to the expansion phase. But as you know, in physics, we only have equations that and laws that describe how something turns into something else. We don't have any equations that say nothing turns into something. So on the other hand, I should say that Einstein's equations tell us that space can expand itself. Space is not a thing like an atom. Space itself can expand. And we even have an idea for how that occurs. There's an idea for what's called inflation in the early universe, a particular quantum field that we can imagine called inflation field that would cause space itself to expand.
So that means space could have existed before matter ever existed.
Yes, we don't know what was there, but the matter that we see today, the particles of the quarks and the protons and the electrons, were probably not there in the early universe. Instead, there was this inflation field. So that's only a guess, but it seems to be a good guess.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the great lecture. My question is, what are your views on quasi-state theory, which was proposed by Fred Hoyle and which are still supported by Jayant Narlikar?
Yes, that was a very interesting and ingenious idea. For people who don't remember, this is the idea that although the universe appears to be expanding, that it actually has an infinite age and that it's been continually replenished by the creation of matter from some unknown process. So they worked very hard to make this theory however, two things turned out not to work. Number one, we've never found a way in which this replenishment by the creation of new matter could occur. And number two, the theory did not predict the proper calculations for the cosmic microwave radiation. I showed you that spectrum of the brightness of the radiation versus frequency, and the steady state theory did not explain that. So I'm afraid that it's not been a good theory.
Okay. So what are your views on string theory?
String theory is very promising and also very difficult, as you know. Let me describe for you why people think it's a good idea. If you calculate the energy surrounding a point object, say an electron, the electrical field energy should be computed as the square of the electric field per unit volume. And because the electric field gets to be extreme near a point, the calculated energy of an electron is infinity. So what's the matter with that? Well, it obviously is hard to calculate infinity. So the idea is, well, maybe an electron is not a point. Maybe it's a string or some higher dimensional object that has just is not a point. So then the calculation of the energy of this object will not be infinity. So now let's see if we can extend this idea to include all of the particles of physics. So far it seems to be working, yes, pretty well, but not complete. People are not satisfied with it yet, and I think the problem seems to be that it's extremely complicated, and it hasn't predicted anything that we didn't already know. So it's hard to be sure that it's a correct idea. Okay, but it's attractive.
Thank you.
First of all, very good morning to you, sir. I have three questions. First of all, we know that every wave has some parameters like wavelength, frequency. So what parameters do gravitational waves have? Secondly, what happens to something when it goes inside a black hole? Can black hole be actually a wormhole that we have dreamed of? And thirdly, what are the current theories of quantum gravity?
Okay, well, that's three difficult questions. I'll start with the easy one. The first one is about the frequency of and amplitude of a gravitational wave. So we have ideas about how they could be produced with frequencies ranging from nanohertz, that is to say a billion seconds per cycle, to kilohertz, thousand cycles per second. So the very, very slow ones occur when a very massive black hole orbits another black hole, say the ones down at the center of our galaxy. The very fast ones occur when a very small object, a small star or a small black hole, orbits another one. So the signal that was already seen starts at a low frequency and ends up rising in pitch to about 200 hertz. So that's very, very fast. So smaller objects could go even faster. So we'll see what happens with the observations. So your second question was about what happens when things fall into a black hole, I think. And the curious thing is that, as seen by us, an object never completes its fall into a black hole. It goes closer and closer to the event horizon, and as we see it, it never actually gets there, which is a surprise, because most people think, well, things fall into a black hole. They do, but we never see the final moment. Your third question was about wormholes, and no one knows if they actually exist or if they could ever be made, but it's certainly an interesting question. I think that one's open.
Yeah. Actually, I have heard that the things stop for some time while entering the event horizon zone, and then they disappear because the light coming from them or the acceleration coming from them stops coming because it has disappeared or fall into a black hole.
Yes, it's true. As things fall in, we lose track of them. We can't see them anymore. The final approach to the event horizon appears to us to be slowed down because of the gravitational redshift, of course. So as things fall in, they appear to go slower and slower because of the gravitational redshift.
And what are some theories on quantum gravity?
I don't actually have a good idea about quantum gravity. It's too hard for me.
And last question, what is the difference between pulsars and quasars?
Oh, a pulsar is a spinning neutron star, as we now know. And it's formed when a star explodes, like that one that I showed you, the Crab Nebula. There is a small remnant of the original star, and it spins about 30 times per second, very fast. Quite often, it's very highly magnetized. And so this spinning magnetized object sends out radio pulses that we can pick up. So that's a pulsar. A quasar is a completely different object. A quasar is a quasi-stellar object that's quite often as bright as an entire galaxy. and it's probably a black hole with material falling in. And of course, as the material falls in, it becomes compressed, very hot, and is able to emit immense amounts of radiation that we can pick up, everywhere from radio waves to X-rays. So those are quasars.
Okay, last two questions.
Okay.
So there are a lot of conspiracy theories that NASA has found evidences about alien life and that they are hiding it from the world. What do you have to say about that?
I can't imagine that we would ever keep that secret. My friends are talkative. So I can't imagine we could ever keep a secret of that sort. Could you?
Thank you for entertaining our questions so long after your lecture, sir. I, again, have two questions. The first question, sir, is about the nebula. So we assume, can you hear me?
Yes, but wait a moment. I'm going to see if I can increase the volume here. Okay, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. So we assume an initial mass composition during the formation of a star. So how does that, and you said that after a nebula has exploded, I mean, I think a nebula is the death star. So how does that affect the initial mass composition of the space around it, and how does that help the formation of new stars? And so secondly, we know that the sum of all natural numbers is a divergent series. So how do we accept that it is actually minus 1 by 12 and use that in string theory?
Well, the first question I can address. The question of how do the nebulae are affected by the explosions of stars. As an example, we think that the nebula, the cloud of gas that produced the solar system, was actually affected by about 1,000 different supernovae that exploded and contributed their debris to this nebula. So many, many sources for the chemical elements that we now have in the solar system. The effect that those chemical elements have is actually quite large on the formation of the star. The star has to collapse, and in the process of collapsing from the nebula, it gets hotter and hotter because of the energy being produced from liberated from the gravitational force. And for the collapse to complete, that energy has to go out again. So that happens because of the chemical elements that are in the gaseous material. Particularly carbon monoxide, and later on other chemicals control that heat distribution process. So the final phases of the formation of a star are very much dependent on those chemical elements, which is one of the reasons why the first stars are different from the others. The first generation of stars after the early universe were made of pure hydrogen and helium and without all these other things, so they would have formed differently.
And the second,
the second question I cannot answer.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Okay.
Good morning, sir.
Yes, good morning, good afternoon.
Yeah, Hemant here. Sir, my question is, what is the future of partnership between ISRO and NASA?
I don't know exactly, but I think it's very possible that we will cooperate more and more. We've already done some cooperative projects, and I think ISRO has accomplished some wonderful things recently with the projects that have succeeded. So as ISRO is more and more supported in India and international partnerships become more and more possible, I think many things will happen. So I can't tell you what they will be, but I think we should be open to them.
Thank you, sir. This lecture enhanced our knowledge. It was a great honor for us having you with us. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for coming. It's a pleasure to meet you.
Namaste.
Yeah. Sir, thank you very much. This it is really, really beautiful, and it's a great opportunity, I think, that we've all got here today. and we're going to cherish it for a long time. Great inspiration, and we were inspired by your inspirations as well. So, is this something that you wish to say to our team here, Technovanza at VJTI?
Yes, I would like to say thank you for that, or organizing this event, and courage as you seek to find a path to use your curiosity and your interest to help solve the problems of the world. It'll be very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. So we'll end the broadcast.
Okay.
Later on.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please maintain silence.
You do wait for 2 minutes, and in your gathering, I just want to thank one special person who's been here with us, and his help was really instrumental in organizing today's lecture. So I want to invite Samuel Thomas to please come here, and I'd like Heyman to present the memento to him. Thank you very much. Now please proceed from that row, please start proceeding out.